Pellizzi has given seminal contributions in quantitative theory, statistical physics, and in interdisciplinary research, notably in optimization theory. In 1992, he received the Boltzmann Medal for his work on critical phenomena and on disordered systems. His prestigious prize was followed by many others, the Dirac Medal in 1999, the Fermi Award in 2002, the Microsoft Award in 2007, the Lagrange Prize in 2009, the Max Planck Medal in 2011, the Nature Prize for Mentoring in Science in 2013, and the recent High Energy and Particle Physics Prize for the study of the dynamics of quarks and gluons. He is a member of the American Academy of Science. Despite being a scientist of exceptional breadth, I would like to add and remark, a personal remark, that Giorgio is an extremely kind person, available to students, and always ready to give advice. So, thank you, Mr. Giorgio.
Okay. Stefano, thank you very much for this, this introduction. And just because you mentioned that the prize that I got for the European Energy Physics for the Altavelli-Pellizzi equations for evolution of gluons and quarks, with also Dossinger and Lipatov, and the prize shared also with Guido Altavelli. I have to tell you the sad news that Guido Altavelli passed away yesterday night. He had a stroke and he died quite very fast away. So this is a very sad news that just because Stefano mentioned it, I want to mention the prize that I shared with Guido. I want to share with you the sad news. Okay, now going to the subject of today. My idea, my talk, is to discuss the physics of jamming. By the way, do you have a pointer or something? Well, I mean, I will start from a very general idea. The thing is that if you can take objects of different size and shape, and if you put together, these are very hard substances that are nearly incompressible. Now, if you have a pile of this type of material, they are completely blocked, one with another one. Now, there are many questions in that arise, and this is also lot of connection with the standard physics of general material when you're doing this object. And in the real world, friction is, there's some strange noise when I speak, so I don't know. The real world, the friction is important, and if you have what I would consider in this case, the situation in which the possible value of the angle of contact are essentially 90 degrees, and therefore the limit of delta may be very small. Of course, depending on the material, you may have delta large and delta small, of course, if you are doing a computer simulation, delta may be very, very small. May be exactly equal to zero, sorry. And now, let's... So there are many questions that in this framework that we are going to ask. How the property of the material depends on the density. The point is that if you create this object, you shake it, the object, the material becomes more dense because moving, I mean, you shake after you stop to shake. the material become more dense because many holes are filled, and also you can do slow compactification, which you start to push the material very strongly after you move much slowly. After this case, there will be some particles, some objects with some contact, some others that are not in contact. We would like to ask the network. Now we would like to ask which is the distribution of the distance between particle and other particle, and which are the property of the box. Now, if you consider object of the previous type, it is clear that this is a rather messy and the things that are going to discuss only in the case of spherical object. Therefore, this is the typical thing that you are interested in, and one can do a lot of many experiments. This is a very nice shaking machine for plastic sphere. You see that here the sphere are moving after the rest, and now you can measure in one way or another one the property of the collection object that are obtained in this way. Now it's quite clear that this object, just because of the here gravity plays a role. If you do the experiment without gravity, the things will be not in contact, but just because you have gravity, you have objects that are in contact this way. Now, the typical, there are many kind of measurements that you can do. For example, you can take a packing of spheres of glass, and now this, depending on how you compactify, you can just obtain the system with area and higher density, not infinite density, but the density may be higher, and you look to the force that you need to push a cylindrical rod into this packing of sphere at a certain depth of 40 millimeter, 60 millimeter, and you see that you have something that from the viewpoint of statistical mechanics looks very similar to a phase transition, because up to this you have a behavior of this type and after the behavior change. So this is a typical type of problem or quantity that you can do with a macroscopic object, the other type of experiment. This is an experiment. You have a container. You have glass beads of a few millimeter, and you put more than 100,000 of these glass beads in a container. Now you put all these objects in a standard tomographic apparatus, the one that you use for medical purpose. You can use an X-ray object, or you can use a magnetic nuclear resonance, depending on the type of material. And you reconstruct, and the things that you reconstruct, that you can reconstruct the position of all these more than 100,000 particles with a certain accuracy. Now, the next thing that you propose is that just because tomography has half a millimeter with some errors, which is some small fraction, but it's not of the radius of the sphere, you can do the same procedure that people are doing with X-ray reconstruction of protein. You add together the information of X-ray with the contact information that the particle has been in contact and form a stable configuration. Now, when you do these things, you can measure the typical object that you do in the liquid, the radial correlation function. No, the radial correlation function is just by definition zero, a distance between less than the diameter of the sphere, because it's quite evident that the sphere not really have sphere, so they cannot go a smaller distance. They have a delta function here, because the sphere attaching. There is some structure at equal to 2, which more or less we have some indication why this should be present by standard liquid theory. And the thing that they have is quite surprising, that apart from the delta function at distance 1, you have an apparent divergent of the correlation function at a distance near to 1. Which is the physical meaning of this divergence? Well, this is something that a priori was completely unexpected. Of course, this is a numerical experiment, but the same feature appears also in numerical experiment. When it appeared, it was completely unexpected. And of course, the delta function here is quite clear. It corresponds to particles that are in contact. However, you have a very strong excess of particles in this region here, which means that there are particles that are in quasi contact, and they have a distance which is slightly higher than the nominal distance of the particle. Now this is quite surprising, and if you look, you do a magnification of this region here, you see more that you have a singularity here. And if you put this, all the everything on a log scale, you see that you have more or less one decade in which you see a type of parallel behavior, which an exponent which is roughly speaking a point of 5. And also therefore this is you don't have a very large region here. You have somewhat limited statistics because you have only 100,000 particles, so you cannot follow these things here for longer for wide region. And also you see something like a power, but it's not clear which is the exponent. Anyhow, this means that from real experiment that you have something that is quite unexpected, that you have much more quasi contact than you would expect, because the simplest natural theory. I mean, if you are doing, if you are doing for the things from a crystal, of course this region will be completely empty. But if you do a very simple theory, you would expect that distribution is flat. And what is certain and clear that this distribution is not flat in this region here. And there is this type of divergence of the correlation of the correlation function that should be explained. Now, just to have some visual ideas of some typical things that you can see with the Gemini, and this is something similar with other things that we observe with granular material, you can take a photoelastic disk. A photoelastic disk is a disk, first of all, just as you expect, and it's a slightly elastic disk. And what happens is that when you have the disk, when there is a pressure on the disk, it changes the polarization of the light which travels the disk. So therefore you send some light, you measure the polarization, and looking for validation, you can see if the disk there is a pressure on this disk. Black disk at the disk where there is no pressure, and the disk that is strong colored at disk where there is a strong pressure. So these things are completely homogeneous. If you don't use a polarized light, you will see something that is completely fully homogeneous. However, if you use polarized light, you will discover that the forces concentrate in some region in these arcs, and also that there are relatively large regions. You see, the size of the particle can be just seen from this dot here. So this region is also 10 particle size, where are more or less completely free of forces. Therefore, you find that it's clear that if you start to analyze a system of this type, there is a lot of argument that you have that is characterized by some correlation length that is quite large, and that the behavior should be in some sense comparable to what happens to phase transition real world in phase transitions, where you have a large correlation function, some correlation that have power type decay, and so on. Of course, the fact that power type decay should be checked, but the fact that in some sense you get the effect of these things of the type. The other type of experiment that you take a system where in the beginning there is no pressure, therefore you see everything in flat, and after you add a pressure this point here, pushing something here, this is quite like the hands of the man that is pushing this road. And now you see that there are some forces, just because the system stays in a container, there are some forces that go from this point here up to infinity, but these forces are not spread, very spread distance, but they go on some kind of network that is localized in this region. So there's a point here where the force is very strong. This is the point, the region here, where the force is quite small. And there's all this type of structure that you like to understand, and it's clearly that it's not trivial to do the theory of this object from scratch. There's some understanding, but not completely, of the physical mechanism that you have with this type of structure there, but the full theory is still absent. Okay, now suppose now that we want to do something, at least I want to do something. Now, the simplest thing is to take this system, cancel all the most of the non-equilibrium feature, which is very difficult to treat, and try to bring the problem in the framework of standard equilibrium statistical mechanics, because standard equilibrium statistical mechanics is a framework in which we have a lot of tools. And now the idea is essential. Well, we can consider this system as a hard sphere, classical hard sphere, characterized by potential of this type, which is infinity for less distances equal to zero at some distance. This, in some sense, is the simplest non-ideal gas that you can do in statistical mechanics, and as you may expect, has been strongly studied in the past. Now, people know that if you take these things in three dimensions, we know that if you go to very strong, to high coefficient air pressure, the system has to crystallize, but in some sense you can, if you do the things relatively, if you do the compression relatively fast, you can avoid the crystallization, and therefore you can just forget that there is a crystal phase, and study the system will remain always in the fluid phase at any value of the pressure. And another variation of the system is just harmonic sphere, in which you have energy which is zero at all these cases, but for smaller distance it's not infinite, but have some dependence. And now the thing that you're interested in the situation where the particles are in contact and such non-contact that they cannot move. Now, for atmosphere, it's clearly what it means, that you have to go to the infinite pressure limit, and when you have infinite pressure limit, all possible voids are filled, and at least the voids that you can fill by small movement, and the particle completely blocked. Now, one of the things that you can do, or you can do infinite pressure atmosphere, or you can take this model at zero temperature. Of course, at zero temperature may have one phase where the energy will be equal to zero, and the other phase where the energy will be different from zero, and however you say the transition point from zero to non-zero energy. Therefore, there are two models are equivalent, and depending from different situations, you can consider this model or this model. This model is simple from the theoretical analysis. And therefore, we go back to the problem of taking a system, R-sphere, and looking to what happens when we go to the infinite pressure limit. Now, therefore, the things is essentially the following. At a certain moment, suppose that we consider the case of harmonic sphere at zero temperature. At low density, this sphere will be not overlap, because any possible overlap is going to cost a subtraction energy. At the jamming point, which is just the point where the sphere touches, this will be the jamming point, and after the sphere will start to overlap, and this will be another phase. So from this point of view, the jamming point is considered the critical point where separates the region where the particle has zero energy to the situation where the particle have non-zero energy. And we are interested, the point is that we are interested to understand which is the physics that happens in this particular situation here. And of course, and one of the questions that you're asking here, you can see here that you have, or here, that you have a two quasi contact, that particles that stay at nearly at a very small distance one from the other one. Oh, however, this is not obtained by simulations. This is just someone that sit down and drawn the picture. And sorry. Okay. So let me do the from this point of view. Now, just because I'm interested, let me try to put these things in a more general phase diagram. The phase diagram will be some kind of phase diagram, in which here I have the density, and here I have the temperature. Well, I can expect, I'm going to, as I told you, I'm going to neglect the crystallization. If I'm thinking of this type of system, I would expect, well, the typical thing that will happen is that the system may stay in a liquid phase, and this is the typical thing that you may expect, and at a certain moment you're going to have the system we know, both from numerical simulation and from experiment, colloids and so on, that there is a certain moment, there is a glass phase where the system is, the correlation time in time become very large. And the glass phase essentially corresponds to the situation in which the diffusion times become very, very large, and this means the diffusion practically stops, and each particle is allowed to do some kind of movement, but the movement is only a fraction of the radius. Therefore, in this point here is a situation where the particle of the system is jammed. That the particle can do zero movement, because each particle is blocked by the other one. And this region here is a situation where the diffusion is infinite, that the particle may diffuse as usual. And the glass phase is a phase where the particle may understand, may absorb, may move over a small amount, but they are blocked in certain kind of cage. Therefore, it's quite clear that if we want to understand the physics of germ state here, we cannot think of applying the standard statistical mechanics for the liquid, that would be the virial expansion whatsoever for going this region here, but we have to cross this type of the glass transition, and the germ state would be just essentially in the glass region. The thing that is quite clear that if in this situation a slightly decreased density go from this situation point to this point here, the particle will have the possibility of doing such movement, but just because they are globally blocked by the other particles, there should be no diffusion. So the point is that understanding the physics of the germ state, you need to have at least a partial understanding of the physics of glasses and of the possible glass transition that separated this region by that region. Now, one thing, let me just enter in details. Maybe I will skip these details and I will go on. One thing that you can do is also not only real experiment, but you can do numerical experiment. Numerical experiment is the advantage that you can have a lot of statistics. If you do an integral experiment with macroscopic quantity system, and also because you're doing numerical simulations, you can measure the position of the particle in high precision. If a double precision is not enough, you can go to quadruple precision, but it's clear that the ratio of error on the position of the particle is out of question. And one can see the following thing, that if one can do the same experiment as one is doing with viscoelastic disk, and if one doing this experiment at far from jamming, one sees that the network of forms at that moment the system become homogeneous at that distance. This is you push something here, you look how the force propagates. And when you are near to the jamming point, the situation changes, and you have a very strong network of forces. So, in other words, you see that the jamming is really a critical point, and there is some length that is going to diverge at this critical point. Essentially, the response length, the length up. At which, if you do some perturbation here, this perturbation propagates and affects the rest. Therefore, it's clear that you have to, that at the end, the understanding of the jamming transition will be, or the jamming point, one should use some of the tools that have been developed in the field of phase transitions. So that this is what you should do. Now, of course, the first things that you can try to do is some kind of phenomenological theory. The phenomenological theory has been developed by many people, among them Jürgen Nagel and Wart. And essentially the idea of skipping the details is that when you do a small perturbation of the system, you have a very large arrangement of the system, and this means in some sense that the system is marginally stable. Therefore, it's stable, but if you do some kind of perturbation, is this things change quite a lot. The reason is quite simple. If you have a set of spheres that are in contact, another set of spheres that are well separated from, from him and she are well separated, it's clear that if you do a perturbation, this will be the perturbation will propagate around the network of sphere. On the other hand, if one sphere has a six contact and one quasi contact, if you do a perturbation on this object, it may touch the other contact and release from the previous touch the quasi contact and release from the old contact, and this will be some kind of strong changement of the system, and therefore the network of contact is also, if you put an arbitrary small force, is going to change a lot. Okay, this is some kind of phenomenological theory. From this phenomenological theory you can start to do some theory. Sorry, in this formula is missing a one, I forgot to add, I'm sorry. And now the thing that you can start to look at different local quantities. I mean, the simplest thing is just, suppose that I want to study the ferromagnetism. The simplest thing that I can look is how the magnetization at the critical points depends on the magnetic field, or at magnetic field equal to zero, how the magnetization depends on the temperature. This is a local quantity. The other things that I can measure, I can start to measure correlations, and correlations depend from the distance. So let's refer to the analysis of local quantity. The first local quantity that we have already encountered is the correlation function, R minus D, and this is going to diverge to the power gamma. One other quantity that is quite important, that is essentially the probability of having a force F. Now the probability of a force F has some power law at F equal to zero with some exponent theta. And the other things that you are saying is the following. If you take look to a given particular sphere, you can look how much is may able to move, and when the pressure is infinite, we will not be able to move at all. But when the pressure is large, it will be able to move a certain amount, and this is going down like a certain power. Now you can do some kind of phenomenological analysis, and doing this phenomenological analysis, you find that this exponent are related one to the other one. This should be k minus 1 of k, and the large scale simulation gives something of this type. With gamma theta equal to 4, k equal to 1.4, and therefore from this viewpoint you say, well, I have this phenomenological theory. This phenomenological theory is capturing the physics of the system, but at this level we are completely enabled with this type of argument or understanding with why. Of course, the stressing exponent depends for only for one exponent, let's say theta. However, you should do some theory in order to get the value of this exponent. Now, as we know, the simplest way, but the standard way to do the computation of the critical exponent is to develop a mean field theory, do a computation of mean field theory. And once that you develop a new field theory, you can try to play with the renormalization group to understand what happens. Of course, you can do other types of computation. If the model can be soluble as the easy model could be, you don't have to derive new field theory and so on. Okay, So the point was the following, that if you try to do with Giamponi the first version on field theory, and in the first version of field theory that we obtained something that was quite disappointing. That we obtain that theta and gamma equal to 0 and k equal to 2. This number were 0.4, 0.4, 1.4, and this was certainly not good from the physical viewpoint. And now let me try to describe how can one construct the mean field theory for this type of model. Essentially, the idea, well, we have to discuss what we have to do to discuss mean field theory. Well, the idea that we say, well, the particles stay in some cage, and just for simplicity, for the type of computation, we assume that the cage Gaussian, and just because this was an uncontrolled approximation, we have to do some uncontrolled approximation on the particle we are moving in the glass, and this with the fact that mean field theory was not correct, it was not so surprising to us. However, at that moment we have discovered that when the dimension of the system becomes very, very large, when dimension goes to infinity, well, you know, when dimension goes to infinity, mean field theory is usually correct, because each particle interacts with many, many other particles, and one can prove that the approximation of Gaussian of the shape of the cage that we did in finite dimension was correct in infinite dimension. Essentially, it's some consequence of the typical central limit theorem. And the other thing that is quite surprising, that the exponents are practically constant in a high dimension. You can make some measurement of the exponent doing simulation, not real experiment, but doing simulation in high dimensions. Doing simulation in high dimensions has some advantage that in high dimensions there is no crystallization, and there is no trace of dependence of the exponent up to the dimension. So this means this was a strong thing that the mean field theory should be correct in very large dimensions. And however, the first attempt that we've done for mean field theory, mean field theory was not correct. So the thing that happened, now let me just show a typical example when I make the statement that the exponents do not depend on the dimension. This is a typical measurement of the size on which how much the particle can move at finite pressure. Here you have the pressure that go from 10 to the 2 to 10 to the 8. Of course, in a computer simulation, we have no problem in sending the pressure to higher and higher value. And this is the side of the cage. And now you see in the point in dimension 3, 4, 6, and 8, one that are normalized to the same value here. They are essentially the same, the dependence on the pressure the same. It just to give an idea of the precision that you get the exponent, that this line, it will be done with k of the order one, or 1.4, and this line is the order of k equal to 1.5. So you see that you can distinguish 1.4 from 1.5. quite easily, and that you don't see any dependence whatsoever of the dimensions. So this is quite extraordinary, because if you have the magnetization expansion of the temperature, we know that in dimension higher than 4, we have the critical exponent is equal to 1/2. When you go in dimension 3, the exponent bit is 1/3, and dimension 2 is generated, so on. So it's strange that this thing apparently does not depend on the dimension. The point is that now the real power problem is to compute what happens in a dimension, which is this exponent k, in the infinite dimension. Okay, now the reason for which our previous computation was the following was essentially a very simple physical argument. So let me just have this cartoon to discuss the typical the glass transition. So let me, this is something that should be in phase space, where particles may move in phase space. Now, if you stay in the liquid phase, what happens is that in the liquid phase, the particle may move everywhere, and everywhere, and this is essentially a connected region. When you start to arrive to the glass transition, these regions here are separated in some cage, so the system may move in this region here for quite fast, but this is a small region of the phase space, and there's a small channel for which we connect this region to this region, so the probability of jumping from here to here is quite small, and therefore in this situation we will see that the diffusion constant will be non-zero, because you can go from one region to another region, but this will take a large time. And at a certain moment, at least in schematically, you could say, well, this region becomes very small, the diffusion constant becomes very large, and the time to jumping from one barrier to another barrier, to one cage to another cage, becomes very, very large. Now, it's a lot of discussions that were nearly one century old, if this time from going from here to here is really... Now, you have this region here, so below the glass transition, you have this possibility, the system breaks down in different regions, and you have a practically zero probability of going from one region to another one. Practically zero probability means that at the final thing, that this probability will go from one valley and another valley, at least, let's say, 20 order of magnitude smaller than what happens in the liquid. If it's really zero, non-zero, this is a long story that I will not try to discuss. Now, the new phenomena that we discovered doing analytic computation in high dimension, that there's another phenomenon that was completely people were not aware that was possible, that this once that you have formed the system in a cage, and therefore each given molecular particle may move in a certain region, we have a certain moment where we have a further type of bifurcation in which each of these regions breaks down in smaller regions, which become smaller and smaller, up to the moment when the pressure goes to infinity, that we have lots of possible configuration for our sphere, for our system of sphere at infinite pressure. And now, if one follows analytically this type of phenomena, one discovers that the distribution of this point in phase space is fractal, and this is something completely different from the picture that would have neglected these things here, that corresponds that one point is isolated from the other point. So this if you all this type of computation can be done in an explicit way, in the limit where the dimension is very large, one obtains the fact that this distribution of possible configuration, one configuration is surrounded by many other configurations which are quite near to the other one, is clear that it has a very strong effect all the property of the jump state at infinite pressure, and now one can try to do the explicit computation, and I will skip the technicalities, and at the end of the computation, And then the computation one find quite surprising result. Then the exponent one can one find that the marginal stability, that the phenomenological theory based on marginal stability is correct, and one can find the accurate value of the critical exponent. Here I just put the first 5 digits, and the thing that is quite remarkable that why the critical exponent of mean field theory are very near to one. What happens is that the critical exponent you get, sorry, a rational number, 1/2, 1/3 and so on, this number apparently do not look a simple rational number, and indeed there have been computed some kind integral, sorry, eigenvalue questions, and let me. Okay, and if I, and indeed, just this line here is exactly the prediction that we get for the exponent from our simple theory in infinite dimensions. So you see that while we have analytic proof that these things, this object will be the theory in infinite dimension, we do not, we are not, this is an extremely good contact agreement with the result in finite dimension, and the success of the theory is somewhat embarrassing because one would not expect that mean field theory is going to give such a good result in finite dimensions. Now we have there are many things that should be done. For example, one problem is that we have to understand what happens to the long range correlation. I told you already that there is some evidence that there are long range correlation. One should measure that some measurements are present of the decay of these long correlations, and have one, in the same way that in mean field theory, that for ferromagnet we can conclude the correlation function of the magnetization, and doing Ostern-Ostern theory, we should do the same theory here, and we should be able to do the value of the exponent, and this is the value of the way that the correlations decay in large distance. And also one would like to understand if there is one exponent that characterizes the decay of correlation, or there's many exponents that characterize, and some numerical computation should be doable, and analytic theory can be done, and it is quite likely that one is going to end up at a certain moment with a scaling invariant theory that is going to behave in some scaling invariant theory for which we have to understand the correlation and so on. Now, there are many open problems. Because one of the things that we would like to understand is we would like to consolidate the theory. We would like to understand why it works and how big are the corrections, because one thinks to say that the correction is small for I don't know why, and it's just a lucky result that you get the result in 3 dimensions. And the other thing to say, well, understand the theory, I have computed the correction to mean field theory, and the correction to mean field theory is small. The other things that you would like to understand, that if you can find other system at which this idea can be applied, which is the university class. And the other things that one would like to extend the whole theory to quantum case. Well, because when we say that, because most of the idea that people are doing of the behavior of quantum glasses is that the behavior of quantum glasses at lower temperature of the plane from the classical landscape, and this picture of the classical landscape is completely different from the one that one usually has. The other question that I would like to discuss, if the gardener transition, just because I was discussing all these theories based on the systems of gardener transition, I would like to discuss if the gardener transition really exists in a three-dimensional system. And we have done a few studies of these things by numerical, both in infield theory, realistic mean field theory for three dimensions, but I will skip these things here, and the other things that we have done before really hard system. This last paper is nearly finished. The last data that I'm showing are not yet published, but we are going to publish soon. And the idea is this. Let me just discuss, this is something like a mean field theory computation, but it's useful to understand the physics of the system. Just because I'm interested in large in the region where the pressure is going to infinity, this line I put the inverse of the pressure, and these things I put the density in some scale, and we have and this is what we expect for the system to stay in if we stay in the liquid phase. And therefore this will be just a liquid phase, which is quite simple. And in this type of system, we can always thermalize the system in this liquid phase, so all these points here of the liquid phase are reachable. However, the things that become interesting, suppose that I start from one point of the liquid phase, and I start to decrease the density or increase the density. Increase the density or decrease the density. What happens that if I start from this region, which is quite compact, because it's very large value of the density, if I compress the system, I immediately go out of equilibrium, because the system in reality is confined in one region of the phase space. In order to remain at equilibrium at higher pressure, to completely change to some global arrangement of the system. So the system, if we compress in this region, we compress the system, we go out of the equilibrium region, and also if we decompress the system, we will go out of equilibrium. So the typical things is the following, that we have one line which is equilibrium line. From this region here, and if we start from the equilibrium line and we start to compress, the things that happen, so we have a line of this type which are completely out of equilibrium. The point where these things is going to change is the called glass transition, dynamic transition. What happens is that these things here, when we are compressing the system in order to go to infinite pressure, before to arrive to the infinite pressure point, we have a region here where this type of transition that corresponds to the breaking, corresponds to the fact that the different cage breaks into subcage. Now the fact that the different cages are going to break down into subcage means that there would be a very large time to go from one cage to another cage. So for example, some kind of correlation time are going to diverge in this region here. The computation that we have done for the GEMMI are done in this region here that correspond to infinite pressure, but just because they were essentially based on the system, so this transition here, Gardner transition, this region here for the system, is clearly that we have one thing that we would like to understand, that if we really, this type of picture is correct for real 3D image 5-3 minutes? Okay, 4 maybe. 3, I don't know. Okay, but we'll not take too much time. So this is that, so therefore we start to do with Ludovic Bernier, Berthier and other, the computation for real 3-dimensional RCS system. We have RCS system, we have started from some configurations that Berthier was able to produce with a computer that is extremely well thermalized, and therefore they are very thermalized, also very, very high density. If you start now, the things that happen, now the things that we can do, we can start, this is just for the liquid, what happens in the liquid phase, and if you just use the liquid density of state, the liquid, equation of state for the liquid, this is what happens, this is a theoretical prediction, this is at the point, so this is very natural. And what happens is at that moment we have something like the glass transition, and therefore if we instead of doing a very careful thermalization, we just increase the pressure relatively fast, what happens is the system from this point here moves down according to this line. And at when you stay at infinite pressure, you arrive to this point here that corresponds to Gemini. However, what we have seen numerically is that apparently when we are doing this operation of compression, there's one point where we have something like what we do, some kind of divergence of correlation time. And we see that the arise of long-range correlation. The typical things is the following. I can have, these are the particles for which I'm doing the experiment. This particle, this is a binary mixture. Therefore, one type of particle is yellow, the other part is different color. And I put the diameter of the particle. It's essentially is the amount of which the particle can move. Therefore, and if you look to this system here is something that is homogeneous. And now, I mean, not how much it can move, how much it does actually move in the simulation. And here is the result that you get in this region here below the Gaussian line, that the system becomes highly heterogeneous, and this means that there's a long correlation length which is the other side of the box, because there are some regions here where the particle can move a lot, and some voids where the particles are really blocked. So this means that we can identify in this way this Gaussian line, and this is essentially what was expected, because the computational exponent here that were in a perfect agreement with the numerical simulation were supposing the existence of the Gaussian line more like of this shape, and this is exactly what we are going to see. Okay, therefore, let me just half minute of conclusion. Therefore, the conclusion is essentially that we have a good starting of a theoretical understanding of the behavior of jump system in this region here, and these things is based on, and this thing was based on the hypothesis that there is an extra transition that has never been observed before in the glass phase, and if we look to the transition in the glass phase, you will really see it, and it's more or less in the typical phenological properties that we expect for the theory. Therefore, this means that all the phase-phase picture of glasses at higher pressure, at least for us here, but we suppose for other things, are going to be changed by the systems of this extra phase, and also, quite reasonable, also the theoretical prediction for quantum case will be somewhat affected. Okay, thank you.
So the session is open for questions. components which are, in the case of the jamming transceiver,
yes, yeah,
which are quite approximate by mean field. So does it apply for the upper critical dimensionality of
if you just look to the delta per phase value, one would say the upper critical dimensionality, that is the dimensions at which mean field theory comes to be correct, is likely to be 2, or less than 2. That would be quite strange, because for most of the situations that we have, the upper critical dimension is 4 and 6 and so on. So the only way that I can answer in a more precise to this question is just to compute analytically the upper critical dimension, which is not a simple task, and after I can, the numerical data suggests that it's very high. Of course, it's not, you cannot measure the exponent of less than 1%. And therefore, if you they agree with the theory with less than 1%, one tends to assume that they are equal to the theory, but that's maybe not true. Yes.
I have the complementary question. So, I have the complementary question. So, in 1D, do you still have the transition? Is the model solid?
No,
oh, just one. In
1D,
the lower critical dimension of this
photogenic
transition.
No, in 1D, the thing is completely trivial, because in 1D, when you go to infinite air pressure, you have one line of particles that touch the other one, and they are no void. I mean, all the things is the possibility, all the discussion is related to the fact that once that you have that the particle may switch from one contact to another one. If you stay in one dimension, you don't have any. Of course, I don't know, well, probably also if you do the things on a strip, it's quite likely that on a strip so will be just the one thing from one dimension. So one dimension is everything is trivial. In 1.1 dimension, I don't know analytically. And I don't see any possible way to do simulation for spheres in 1 plus 0.5 dimension and so on. Because for spins, I can think to do using some fractal lattice and so on. But I cannot understand how I can put that sphere in some space with 1.1 dimension, so I don't know.
A very general question. The concept of marginal stability, the wording of marginal stability, I would say, has been sometimes used in other fields, for example, the physics of biological matter. So, do you think this kind of approach can be exported? For example, I think of the problem of protein folding of
well, look, this is a field on which I'm not expert. It's absolutely true that the word marginal stability is quite old. I mean, the first case I know the use of marginal stability was in the study of the dynamics of spin glass type system, and in the 90s. And probably was introduced by Wallins and others that also done works on proteins. If this idea may be useful from problem, I think that we can discuss it privately, but I have no answer whatsoever to your question.
Giorgio, there is another example of systems where you have mean field exponents even in two dimensions, and this is neuronal activity, spontaneous bursting activity exhibits mean field exponents. In this case, we understood this weird behavior, because also we were surprised by this, because in the case of the brain, correlations propagate over substrate where close paths for the propagation of correlations become marginal, irrelevant. When you have a correlation mainly propagate on tree-like, not really tree because we are finite dimensions, tree-like structures, you have the emergence of this mean field exponent. Could be this an effect relevant for your case where you do observe that the network of forces has a very string-like structure?
Well, the question that you ask is certainly extremely interesting, and also one of the reasons for which I think that it's very interesting that we were just thinking if when I was discussing about different models that could be in the semi-neurostatic class, I was thinking of just a neural network. So one idea that we had that neural network could be in the semi-neurostatic class. And Eric takes, we started to do some preliminary computation in this direction, but we have not really, we have some progress in this direction, but we're not finished, so it will be very interesting to discuss later this, this aspect.
Thank you. At the beginning of the talk, when you showed the distribution of forces and the polarization, you had the distribution of the polarization, and I think I saw there's some five-fold symmetry. That is structures which are five-fold. The question
no,
is...
No, no, you're right. It looks some five-fold, but I don't know. I mean, you see, most of my personal analytical understanding comes from infinite dimensions. And in last dimension, we do not have this type of... I think that maybe the five-fold structure may is related to the fact that the angle of contact prefer, or when you have some bifurcation of the line of the arc, you may, I don't know, I mean, I really don't know. You are right that this five-fold symmetry in some of the previous lines, but I don't know why. And also we are very far away from getting these detailed predictions in two dimensions from these things. I think that one should do, I mean, one of the things that I would like to do, but I never had the time to get the picture from the experiment and to do some analysis of correlations with computer, and certainly we are looking to for full symmetry will be great.
So I think we should close the session. The question is not to go.